Okay. I think I'm live. All right. Good Lord. Okay. Sorry, folks. I'm here. It's Thursday, December 29th, a little after 8. You know, the inevitable tech issues. You know, just as it goes. Excuse me. So, welcome to the 9 o'clock daily Christmas vlog I've been doing since the 2nd of December. So, 27 days in later, I think I've only done it two times. So, 25 days technically. I'll definitely be here today, tomorrow, and then Saturday night. Being New Year's Eve, I am definitely not venturing out. I'm definitely not venturing out on Saturday night for New Year's Eve, and I haven't for many years at this point. You know, for the obvious reasons of that, I don't want to be in the line of fire potentially of some drunken moron. I mean, to be honest, I mean, that was a fear even when I was drinking, but I'm not drinking anymore either way. So, you know, just not doing it. So, gonna hang home for the day, obviously, as I do. It's supposed to be raining, apparently, if I'm gonna do some weather in. Yeah, it's gonna rain New Year's Eve night, so just as well, if you think about it, that, you know, maybe stay in. You know, I mean, if you feel the need to drink or whatever, you know, invite some folks over, have them bring their own BYOB, and then if they need to stay over, you know, they get a little too shicker. Yeah, I don't know. I think there's not much, doing this from Rhode Island, obviously. looking at the preview, I'm picking my eyes out. Coming from Rhode Island, is not, as far as I know, there's Providence is not doing anything sort of citywide, if you will. There's various shows and things happening. My friend Keith Munslow does the Empire Review, not doing it at EST 220 this year, which I find interesting. So he's actually going to be doing it at the Wilbury Theater in Providence, but just more toward the Pawtucket area of things. I don't know if it's maybe, I mean, it's not really a bigger venue. If anything, it's a smaller one. So I'm wondering what happened as far as the use of AS220 at that point. There's that. Apparently there are fireworks happening in Warwick on New Year's Eve. So if you feel the need, you have to see fireworks. You know, I am not a fireworks fan. At least of the loud variety, and for obvious reasons that, like, you know, fireworks, loud fireworks, banging and exploding and things like that, are not good for not only our vets, but also our pets. You know, it's already a struggle for vets that may have seen action and war and have PTSD as a result. Things like loud fireworks and explosions don't fucking help. And then obviously with pets, who also don't appreciate loud explosions and things, because that freaks them out, because they don't know what the hell's going on, you know. So, you know, one would hope that, you know, at some point in this country, they will adopt what Italy has done, oddly, considering that the government is currently fairly fascist. that they are shifting over any kind of, I believe, like specifically for New Year's, they're going with silent fireworks. So, you know, fireworks are the same. Like, they don't, the explosions don't need to happen. You know, I think that's a, I think at this point it becomes a situation of like, do we need to see or he and or hear what a war supposedly sounds like? I don't need to. I've had enough of it through my own proxy situation as a you know, an army brat, so I'm cool with it. I'm cool with it going away, put it that way. So today being the 29th, another sort of fairly innocuous day for the most part. You know, not a lot going on as far as other than everything I've already been talking about. You know, didn't really do much today other than you know, I got nothing done around the house. I need to clean the house. I have some projects and things that I got fucking bugger all done today, so the house is a bit of a mess, but you know, big surprise, you know, it's still vacation, so I've still got a few more days. I don't have to be back until Tuesday, so and then it starts all over with all over again. So, you know, there's that. I figured tonight what I'm going to just do, a couple things came to mind. First thing that came to mind, just for shits and giggles, and I'll, you know, as much as I'm going to be doing it on a website up on YouTube visually, I can certainly talk it through on to the folks here on Instagram. But I thought I would do... I thought I would do just some tarot. Now, for those of you who think that I'm, you know, crazy or something, I actually used to be very much into not only astronomy but tarot when I was about 20 years ago, to be honest, 20, 25 years ago. And, you know, I look at it as an innocuous thing that, if nothing else, for, you know, just kind of looking forward into the new year as to, you know, just, you know, what's going to happen? What's the news for the upcoming year, you know? Prosperity, austerity, poverty, you know, I mean, whatever it might be. So I'll probably do a little bit of that. The other thing I'm going to do, obviously I'm going to play some music, as I've been doing. So today being December 29th, one of the things that is a thing, actually, I thought I had it up there. Where is it? It's not up there. I thought I had it up there. Anyway, so today, December 29th, 2022, so 3 years ago on this day, we lost Neil Innes, who of Bonzo Dog fame, as well as Monty Python, as well as The Ruddles, the Innes Book of Records, among other things. A brilliant music pastiche and satirist and parodist, specifically if we're talking parody or satire, we're talking The Ruddles for sure. You know, he was friends with those guys, so he was the best person to do it, along with Eric Idle, that particular project. So anyway, so he passed away 3 years ago this evening. And what I thought I'd do, just I play one of his songs, but I thought, let me look and see if there's any of his other songs I might be able to kind of muddle through. And sure enough, I'm going to muddle through some tonight in his honor. I had the distinct pleasure of meeting him, A couple times, actually. The first time was on my, what would have been, my 41st birthday. Back, well, when I turned 40, the idea was that, like, on my birthday, I would take a trip somewhere, even just a short couple of day, whatever. When I turned 40 at the time, like, you know, I would look for a specific show, potentially, that was happening on my birthday. So, you know, I still try to do that if I keep track of it. However, not really. I'm, you know, traveling right now is just not a good option. I think you don't want to see me in an airport after my flight has been canceled. You know what I'm saying? So anyway, when I was 40, I took a trip to Portland, Oregon, for a reunion of the Firesign Theater, who was doing a show on the night of my birthday. So, and they were doing two shows, so I was there for 2 days in a row, and got to meet them and got to know them a little bit, which was very cool. But then the year after, I decided, okay, well, what's the next one? So 41 years old, and at the time, this would have been, again, 2006, the Bonzo Dog Doodah Band were going to do a 50th anniversary reunion kind of thing, because that would have been the year 1966 when they first got together. The Ginger Geezer himself, Viv Stanshall, was no longer with us because he passed away in 95, I believe it was. But pretty much everybody else was around. So, you know, with Neil Innes at the helm and all the rest of the various Bonzos over the years, etc., with some extra special guests and all this kind of stuff. However, this was taking place in London, England. So I, at the time, again, we're talking 2006, a flight to England and lodging for a couple of days was pretty cheap. I mean, I want to say, God, I want to say like maybe $400 or $500, like all told. So, I mean, I was there for like 3 days or something like that, and fourth day was a travel day or whatever. It took place mostly on a weekend, so I was able to get a good weekend hotel rate. And right in the heart of London, so it was perfect. And I couldn't do that now. I mean, that same deal would set me back a couple of thousand, probably. Just not in the card. So anyway, at the time, so I'm very lucky, I feel, that I got to witness that. So anyway, was able to go to the show. Got, you know, first thing I did is I bought the tickets for the show, because then I was sort of like, all right, well, I got to go now, so I have to get my plane tickets and get that all squared away, and of which I did, and it was you know, a lot of fun. It's actually the other thing that was great. So when we get there, I get in line, and you know, a bunch of us are waiting, and I was talking, and so obviously being in England, and that this is at the time, you got to remember that George Bush was president. Not a popular thing over there in England at the time. So, you know, being an American in a queue for a show in the heart of London, one kind of sticks out like a sore thumb, just because I'm, you know, I was certainly not going to speak with an English accent, because it would have been a bad one. However, I basically get a disclaimer. It's just like, look, I'm American, but don't, you know, don't throw me in with all the other Americans and the George Bush, you know, crowd, because that's certainly not my crowd. Thankfully, I got the thumbs up from the folks I was talking to. That was cool. But anyway, so then they started passing these things out to all the people in the queue, which was basically a little disclaimer. And I wish, here's the thing. I might have it somewhere, but I don't know where it is right now. It was basically a slip of paper that said, we are going to be filming tonight. You know, it's kind of just a disclaimer, like, you know, in any situation where they're going to be filming a show, they have to give the people in the show or in the venue some sort of warning that there's videotaping going on for whatever reason they don't want to be videotaped, right? So they work it out, whatever. I certainly didn't care. If anything, I made sure that, you know, being who I am, that I would somehow get noticed, you know? So on the back of the sheet, and I had like a pen on me or something, I just scrawled on the back of it, from USA, It's my birthday or something like that. and, you know, so the cameras, there's cameras roaming. There's obviously cameras in the rafters in the back and, you know, getting as many angles as possible. But there's, you know, cameras on the stage and they're pointing at the people, and but they're pointing in the crowd. So I made sure that, like, and I was pretty close to the front of the stage too, which was really about like maybe fifth, sixth row or something like that. So I was close. So I was able to hold up the sign, and sure enough, a camera trained on it for a good number, for a good minute or so. And I just went, all right, we'll see what happens. After the show, backstage, and this is what I regret, because at the time, you also, this was 2006, so you don't have a cell phone. No, there's no cell phone, real selfies, really. I had a camera, and the battery was dying, so I wasn't able to get, like, the last picture I was able to take was of, I took one of Stephen Fry. I should have gotten one with him, you know. But I did get his autograph and all this kind of stuff. But I was able to meet, and it's, by the way, it's fucking freezing out too. By the, so it's really cold out. It's a, you know, it's January in England. And backstage show, sure enough, Neil Innes comes out, and he's sort of on his own, and he's lugging his own gear, you know, and going to his car. And he, you know, I got to chat with him a little bit. He signed something, and I mentioned to him that I was from the U.S. and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, at one point, one of the people who was in the band was saying, hey, we're going to have dinner at this place after the show. Are you coming? And I don't know why the fuck, why didn't I go? What am I, a fucking idiot? I don't know. Clearly, at the time, I was an idiot. And I had done the same thing that, like, the year before at the Firesign Theater. Someone had invited me to go to a radio station where they were going to be going, and I didn't go. It's like, oh, dude, what is wrong with you? Anyway, so so that happens. I come back home. Everything's, you know, very cool, very fun night. About a year later, thereabouts, sure enough, the filming or the reunion of the Bonzos was released on DVD, of course, only in England. It wasn't in America. And, of course, I bought it. And sure enough, guess who gets a fairly featured, you know, shot in the right in the middle of the fucking thing is this guy with his little scrawl, hand-scrawled sign from the U.S., it's my birthday. I have to wonder, well, okay, so let me fast forward. So then that happens, obviously. I take a little clip of it. It's up online. It's actually on my, it's on my YouTube channel. So if you go up there, you can check it out. Matter of fact, I bet you I could find it. Hang on one second. Let me do this. For those of you that are on YouTube, I'm gonna actually play it because I can. No, we're going to go to my channel. Let's see if I can find it. I know it should be there somewhere. Let's see. I mean, it's been a long time since I've viewed it, but it should still be up here. Pretty sure. Oh, there it is. Yeah. Okay. All right. So the Instagram folks, you're not going to see it, but if you go to my YouTube channel, and I did put the YouTube, my channel link up on Instagram. I should probably just put it in my my Instagram thing just as a permanent feature. And here's the thing. I think that if I do this right, you should be able to hear it, but I'm not sure because this is where things went awry the other day. So this is a bit of a experiment because I don't know if this is going to work or not. Let's see. Oh, it's working. So on YouTube, you should be seeing this. All right. Keep an eye out. And there I am. It's my birthday here from US.
Does it bust to you? Okay, let's
fucking funny. So if you go to my YouTube channel, it is up there. It's under the box. It says Bonzo Dog Go Dab Band Reunion on 06 on my birthday. And 14 years ago, that's right, it was at the Astoria in London. That's right. I knew it began with an A, I forgot. And it's funny because there's a guy says, I always say hi to you when I view my DVD and think about what a lucky dog you were to be there. Yes, for sure, my friend. And then someone put in rest in peace, sad day, sad loss, and that was 2 years ago. Well, actually 3 years ago, because again, it was 2019, 2021, yeah, 3 years. Those trips were great. And, you know, I did do a third one in 2007. I went to Oakland, California, as Brian Wilson was playing. I forget exactly what the name of the theater was, but it was in Oakland. That was a little bit of a scary one. You know, same thing. It was just a couple of days. I was in this little, you know, cute little hotel thing. It would have been in. It was technically in Monterey, like the you know where it was. Not Monterey. Alameda. That's what it was. It was a little bit far from San Francisco, I didn't rent a car, and I probably should have, because I could have taken a day in San Francisco. So that one was a little weird because in Oakland, you know, not necessarily the safest of cities at the time. When the show was done, of course, I was staying at the end of the show, going at the end of the show, and just sort of waiting backstage just to see if I can meet anybody. And I did, and this is actually connected with Neil Linus. I met my second Ruddle, and that was Ricky Fatar, who at the time was, he's an ex-Beach Boy as well, and he happened to be guesting on the show, the live show, so I got to meet him. I have a picture of him somewhere in my archives with him and I, so that's the only two Ruddles I've met, and then I have seen Eric Idle in person, and I do have all three of the autographs. The only person I've not met or have the autographed is Barry Wong, of course. I need to get on that. Anyway, so this is that was 2007. So anyway, fast forward to about, I don't remember exactly when it was. I want to say it was like 2009, maybe. Yeah, something like that. He was doing a tour of America. It was the last one he ended up doing, because they weren't cheap at the time for them to do. And he was at the Narrows in Fall River, Massachusetts, and of course had to get tickets for that show, which I did, of course. And that was one of those ones where it's like, I mean, it was not full. I mean, we're talking maybe 60% full. That should have sold the fuck out, man. And, you know, I mean, he certainly took it in his stride. I think, that should have been just much fuller than it was. Anyway, so another great show. I've got pictures of that somewhere in the archives as well. Same thing, though, at the end of that show, he was doing meet and greets. Obviously, you remember this is long before COVID. And I was first in line right after he got off the stage. And this guy could not have been sweeter. He was like, so one of the things, like during the show, I blurted out, how sweet to be an idiot. And he just kind of, okay, sat down, played it on the piano. It's like, okay, that's another one to tick off the box, right? Fuck. And then, so I get in line, and I, of course, brought a couple of things for him to sign, one of which was the Rutland Weekend songbook album. I believe I brought, well, I brought something else. I think I brought some sort of one of his CDs or whatever, but I also bought a bunch of stuff. And so not only did I get a picture of him with the two of us doing this thing that he, this was his sort of trademark, was the basically the FU with the hand to the nose. He signed everything, and I didn't ask him to sign everything. He just did, and proceeded to, like, on the Rutland Weekend album, colored in the beard, the half beards that both he and Eric had on the front cover. So it's basically like a work of art, you know. Yeah. So that was the last time he, I think, was in America, and he the last. At the time, I was also on Twitter, so every once in a while we would banter back and forth, which was kind of cool. And then he was doing a, I forget what the name of the concern was at the time, but he was doing, you know, like a GoFundMe kind of thing for an album he was putting out. It's not the GoFundMe page. It was the page that went under and bankrupt because of malfeasance, and they basically were stealing artists and people's money instead of, like, putting it toward the projects that they were being funded. So he lost a ton of money. He sent me a Christmas card, which I do still have, and I thought I had it up on my little mantelpiece here. But I'm not sure. I think it might be in the other room, but anyway. So he sent me a little Christmas card, of course, of which, of course, I kept.
Oh, you know. Did I? Oh. I see it right now. Hang on. Okay. Hang on. That's right. I forgot I had moved it because I needed to move it. But then I never put it back up like an idiot. I need to do that. I'm going to do that right now, as a matter of fact. Because this needs to be a perennial Christmas thing that I do. So anyway.
So yeah. I knew it was in here somewhere. Anyway, so this would have been, you know, again, this, and this was the year before. So in other words, this was sent in 2018. So he had been working on this album. I put money in to help with the funding of it. The concern fell through. Everybody lost their money or whatever. And they very, very nicely, you know, were in touch with everyone regarding it. And you can see the envelope there, hand printed. And basically, this lovely little Christmas card from Neil Innes. And, you know, it basically says, to Joseph, Joe A., a new album by me will be on its way to you next spring. Thank you. Love, Neil Innes. And you can see, and it's backwards on Instagram, which I apologize, but you can see that that is all real there. So, now, what happened, unfortunately, is that when they were trying to work, they were trying to get this to a lot of trouble with the money that they lost and trying to get this album out and finished and all that kind of stuff. And literally just as they were finishing it, he died. He passed away. And in the chaos that that kind of threw, I ended up never getting the damn CD. And I probably at some point, you know, I mean, it's 3 years later at this point, I probably could, you know, mention it, but it didn't matter at that point. You know, as far as I'm concerned, it was money towards someone I respected and cared for and loved, and you know, I'll get the record of it. I do want to get the record eventually because it's his last record before he passed away. So, yeah, so that's 3 years ago. And, you know, that's the story of, you know, the various stories of me with Neil Innes, etc. I think what I'm going to do first, is I'm going to throw a couple of tarot cards just for shits and giggles. So you can see this. I guess the question should be, what is the question that I ask? So I'm on a site that I've used before. It's called facade.com. And you can do tarot, you can do runes, numerology, I Ching, coin flips, biorhythm, stichomancy, I think that's how you say it, bibliomancy. This website has been up for like 20 years, and it's still going. So I don't know if it's just on randomizers or what, but every once in a while, I'll just put something up, and on my name, I'm just going to put in my initials. What does the coming year hold for me? Reversals and a significator. I'm going to get to the free reading and see what happens. So, first thing I know, I've got to select a deck for the reading. I most recently had someone at work actually do a throw for me using a cat deck. And so I might as well, there's a cat people deck here. That might be appropriate. So I might as well just do that one. Let's see. Come on. All right. Now I'm going to select a reading. Now the reading I want to do is, let's see, if I do, well, it would depend on what, so considering my bent for the new year is to being more creative, creating more of that balance that I've been looking for, you know, regarding that stuff. I'm thinking, let's see. Well, there's two ways I could go here. So, though it says Celtic Cross is most popular, fourfold vision has progression of different ways of looking at an object, person, or situation, relationship, twisting path. The twisting path is possible. It's insight into the path ahead of you and choices you must make. So that's possible. That's a good one. Then there's also the creative process, but it's designed specifically to peer into the nature of a project or a creative undertaking. That's possible. The Hagal spread is a tool for revealing the path of spiritual growth. Yeah, I'm working on that. I don't necessarily need more insight into that. Shadow truth spread provides insight into your attitudes and hidden feelings. Not sure what I'm pretty open with my feelings at this point. I don't think I have much to hide, for the most part. The two paths spread provides insight into an important decision ahead of you, the possible outcomes and the forces that draw you toward each of these outcomes, and that's another possibility. The cross and triangle spread is a powerful means of understanding complex situations. The one card spread is the most concise of all spreads, intended to provide a quick take on a situation or reduce it to a single point of meditation. The three fates spread is an exceptionally popular way to gain insight into the emerging arc of the past, present, and future. Okay. I think I want to narrow this down to either the creative process, the twisting path, or the two paths. I'm being drawn to the two paths instead of the twisting path. The twisting path says this is the spread for situations where more than one pitfall may lie ahead. Well, that's probably the realest of all of them, I suppose. The creative process, I've got a pretty good idea of the creative, my own creative process and what it lacks and what it doesn't. So, twisting path or two paths? Yeah, it provides insight to an important decision ahead of you, the possible outcomes and the forces that draw you towards each of these outcomes. I think I'm still drawn to the two paths instead of the twisting path. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do the two paths. I'm going to select a significator, which basically is me. And let's see, of who I tend to be in general. Not the Page of Pentacles, for sure. Definitely not the Queen of Pentacles. Let's see. I might be the Queen of Swords. Yeah. Change it. Well, I don't know about that one. Yeah, definitely not that one. Definitely not that one. Not that one. Well, an invitation or opportunity may soon arise. Arrival, approach, advancement, attraction, inducement, appeal, request, challenge, proposal. And that's the Knight of Cups. So it's a toss-up. The Knight of Cups is what I want. Like, I'm kind of looking towards, like, opportunities that may arise, arrivals, approaches. So like, forward momentum or being aware of what's coming up. Whereas the Queen of Swords is sharp, quick-witted, keen person, intense perceptions. A subtle person may signify a widow or woman of sadness, mourning, privation, absence, loneliness, separation, one who has savored great happiness, but who presently knows the anxiety of misfortune and reversal. I mean, that's more me in a nutshell, to be honest. So let's do this. Why don't we... I'm gonna try and, instead of like harping on that negativity or the obviousness of who I am, which is more of the Queen of Swords, I'm gonna look at being the Knight of Cups, which is inviting opportunity that might arise. Arrival, approach, advancement, attraction, inducement, appeal, request, challenge, proposal. I figure it's a way of getting a sense of like what's coming up ahead for me. So let's do that one. So what does the coming year hold for me? Okay, and the spread has been thrown here. Let's see. So it says, the two-path spread provides insight into an important decision ahead of you, the possible outcomes and the forces that draw you towards each of these outcomes. The Cat People Tarot paints a picture of faraway lands trod by mystical archetypes and their feline companions. This deck is a perfect tool for dreamers and idealists and is a great choice for divining the nature of human imagination. If you would like, blah, 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 you can buy your own. That's not what I'm going to do. The significator, not shown, is the card you have chosen to embody your presence and the focus of the reading. Knight of Cups, an invitation or opportunity may soon arise. Arrival, approach, advancement, attraction, inducement, appeal, request, challenge, and proposal. Now, first card. The top left card represents the first possible outcome. So it's the Seven of Wands, Valor, when reversed. Consternation, anxiety, embarrassment, indecision, hesitancy, causing losses, perplexity, doubt. Well, that's kind of where I'm at. The top right card represents the second possible outcome. Three of Cups, abundance. When reversed, excessive pleasures, overabundance, superfluity. Okay. Loss of prestige, delays, unappreciation. Okay. The middle left card represents the force drawing you towards the first possible outcome. Five of Swords, defeat, when reversed, uncertain outlook, chance of loss or defeat, weakness, possible misfortune befalling a friend, seduction, burial. Oh, boy. The middle right card represents the force drawing you towards the second possible outcome. Two of Cups, love, when reversed. Unsatisfactory love, false friendship, troubled relationship, divorce, separation, cross desires, opposition, disunion, misunderstanding. Yikes. The bottom card represents the critical factor that decides what will come to pass. Eight of Pentacles, prudence, apprenticeship, craftsmanship, a person who learns quickly, candor, frankness, modesty, handiwork, personal effort.
Well,
that's interesting. Maybe I should have gone with the other one. All right, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to actually do two things. Just because at that point, I don't know if I can. Let's see. I'm going to go with the Twisting Path, and I'm going to go with the Queen of Swords, which is who I am. So a different throw. This is the last one, and then I'm going to play some music. What does the coming year hold for me? Twisting Path spread provides insight into the path ahead of you and the choices you must make. This is the spread for situations where more than one pitfall may lie ahead. We've already talked about the Cat People Tarot. The Significator Not Shown is the card you've chosen to embody your presence. And the focus of the reading, Queen of Swords, sharp, quick-witted, keen person, intense perceptions. A subtle person may signify a widow or woman of sadness, mourning, privation, absence, loneliness, separation, one who has savored great happiness but who presently knows the anxiety of misfortune and reversal. The card at the lower left represents the first decision along your path. Two of Cups, love when reversed. Unsatisfactory love, false friendship, troubled relationship, divorce, separation, cross desires, opposition, disunion, a misunderstanding. Okay. The card to the far left represents the first false path that may lead you astray. Three of Cups, abundance when reversed. Excessive pleasures over abundance, same thing. Superfluity, I think is what the hell you say that. Loss of prestige, delays, unappreciation. Card in the middle represents the second decision along your path, Four of Swords, truce when reversed. Activity, circumspection, precaution, economy, guarded advancement, desire to recover what is lost. Sure. The card at the lower right represents the second false path that may lead you astray. Second of Wands, valor when reversed. Consternation, anxiety, embarrassment, indecision, hesitancy, causing losses, perplexity, doubt. The card at the top represents one possible mask of your true destination. Seven of Pentacles, assessment. Ingenuity, growth, hard work, progress, successful dealings, money, wealth, treasure, gain. Okay. Let's leave it at that before I get myself into further trouble with the fates. Good Lord. I don't know. On that note, I'm going to play some music before, lightning strikes or some shit. good Lord. Yeah, and, those are the kind of some of the reasons why I don't really do tarot much anymore, because of I get readings like that that just kind of freak me out. So, yeah. There's a few people on here, at least up on YouTube. But I know some people like to lurk, but I keep mentioning to folks, saying, please pop your name in the comments so I know who you are. And I can say hey and wave at you. All right. Let's see. All right, so I'll like I said, I'm going to do a few things by Neil Innes tonight, and then I'll end with the thing that I've been ending my nights with, a particular tune that puts things in perspective, I think, at least it does for me. I think I need new strings. That's what it comes down to as well. Anyway. Alright. This one is called The Urban Spaceman, and this is written by Neil, and this was done with the Bonzo Dog Doodah Band in 1967, and at the time it was produced by a guy named Vermouth. I forget the exact nom de plume, but it was actually Paul McCartney who produced it. So Apollo V. Vermouth or something like that. Apollo? Yeah, I forget what it is. Anyway, Apollo Vermouth. Vermouth, there we go.
I'm the urban spaceman, baby. I've got speed. I've got everything I need. I'm the urban spaceman, baby. I've got speed. I've got everything I need. I'm the urban spaceman, baby.
For the time, actually, oddly considering. Sorry for the odd noises for those on YouTube. Yeah.
So there's that one.
Let's see. Hang on, I've got a number of, these are sort of only marginally rehearsed because it was such a last minute sort of decision. Let's see. Yeah, so I'm kind of I'm looking at notes here and the chords and the lyrics and things. Yeah. Let's see. So this one's called Another Day. And so, you know, for those of you who don't know the Ruddles, the absolute brilliance of Neil Innes to pastiche lyrics and song titles and specific parodying of multiple of the Beatles songs within one song. This is technically Martha, My Dear, obviously using the, you know, Another Day, which is a Paul McCartney song, specifically, you know, on that score. But, you know, yeah, it's the songs on them on their own have a you know, like it's not mindless pastiche, put it that way. It's very, very pointed. Let's see if I can do this. Oops.
Like these, when enemies can number more than friends, a friend indeed is what I need, not someone who pretends. I'm on my way, I cannot stay another day. You're such a pain, must I explain my every meaning to you? It's such a drag, the way you nag at me and make me feel blue. I'm on my way, I cannot stay. So pusillanimous, so yeah. Nature's calling and I must go there. A glass of wine worth Gertrude Stein, I know I'll never share, but I don't mind. The kind of cross each man must bear. I'm on my way, I cannot stay another day. You're so pusillanimous, so yeah. Nature's calling and I must go
All right, so this next one is actually a piano song, but anyway, so this one is, so the story of this song, because it's a piano song, as recorded by the Ruddles, at the time, and this would have been mid-70s, 77, I think, 78, when All You Need Is Lunch was on TV. I remember watching it at my grandmother's house. It was on Channel 10, you know, this was like primetime television at the time, so to see something like this again was pretty radical at the time. So the theory goes is that a lot of people, because the pastiche and the imitation were so spot on by Neil Innes, that people actually thought it was John Lennon pulling a Beatles like pastiche, you know. Word got around. Apparently John Lennon loved it. George Harrison is in All You Need Is Lunch, so he was in on the joke. No real word from Ringo. Apparently Paul was not amused. I mean, big surprise, right? So since he had the Mickey sort of being taken, so you know, he wasn't too pleased, apparently. Whatever. Anyway, let me see if I can just do a, you know, my pastiche of this as well. All right. Instagram. Yeah, so that was Neil Innes. Cheese and Onions. Oh. You'll pardon me once again, the sniffing and the snorfling and stuff. It was a warm day today. I don't know if you noticed, if you're in Rhode Island or in the Northeast or whatever. A little too warm for fucking end of December, in my estimation. I mean, on the one hand, I save money on heating, I suppose. On the other hand, allergies are just having a fucking field day. So yeah, I'm just fighting the urge to sneeze. Same thing happened the other night too, actually. Let's see, let me do this one because I can. Yeah. So again, for those of you just joining, and I'm doing a little bit of a tribute to Neil Innes, who passed away 3 years ago this evening, of the Bonzo Dog Doodah Band, Monty Python and the Ruddles, the Innes Book of World Records, or Innes Book of Records, which was a six-episode BBC program, which basically was a half-hour episode each of Neil Innes, I think, doing three or four songs, and with a video on top of it, and it's up on YouTube somewhere. I think all of the episodes are, they've never been officially sort of released on DVD, and he was trying to do that before he passed away. He was trying to get them, like, you know, sanctioned, released from the BBC, and I think that they kept giving him trouble. So So they're up there. They're findable. There's also a great website. It's an archive. I think it's still up. I think it's still up online. To be honest, I haven't visited it in a long time. Basically a fan archive of every song that he ever wrote in whatever, you know, project he did, because he also did a lot of children's show work in his later years as well. That was lauded, which we didn't get in America here, so didn't really see that much of. But anyway, so this one is a pastiche mostly of I Am the Walrus. And it's called Piggy in the Middle. And, you know, I'll do what I can here. Let's see.
About a month of Sundays, Toffee knows what we can as far as I can see. Hey, diddle diddle, woo, the cat in the fiddle, woo, Piggy in the middle, whoop, poo, poo, Bible punching heavyweight, evangelistic boxing.
Obviously, the Ruddles version is a lot more psychedelic than mine. But that's a fun song, for sure. Let's see. Let's see if I has any other ones I can do. So there's basically, I didn't prepare as well as I as well as I normally do, I suppose. There was very last minute idea to do Neil Innes songs, so I didn't have a lot of, I don't have, sheets of music, so I am online just looking at some stuff, or looking at the chords and of songs that I remember, and some of them I do, some of them I don't. Let's see. Oh yeah, there was another one I could do. Where is it? I wonder if I could do this one. I can try. Like I said, this is all just rehearsal and farting around, so, you know. Thanks for hanging out. I appreciate it. Let's see.
People were proud in Double Back Alley. Silvers were loud, but ever so pally. People would shout, joking about the smoke and the soot. Mother would put the milk bottles out. Ice cream van talk oh so queer. Double Back Alley takes me back, and in my mind I see happy smiling faces if I flop my memory. Double Back Alley, play me go boo. Sacker and Sally bouncing the ball against the wall, showing the drawers, incoming doors, the dad would call.
The key change. Yeah, there you go. That's what happens when you're doing this shit cold here. So, you know. Let's see. Got a few other folks here on the Instagram. Judson. Hey, how you doing, man? It's been a while. Let's see. Let me see if I can do one more, and then maybe I'll pivot to some other stuff. Because, there's... Again, a lot of Neil Innes stuff that I did not rehearse. this one is sort of, well. That's the riff.
I feel good, I feel bad, I feel happy, I feel sad. Am am I in love? I must be in love. I feel rich, I feel poor, I'm in doubt, I feel sure. Am I in love? I must be in love.
Oops, shit.
Any time of the day I can see her face when I close my eyes.
Wow, okay. Okay, fucking threw me off right there. Shit. I forgot all about that bridge.
Any time of the day.
That's the one. Yeah, there's a little augmented chord in there. Little fucker. Neil. Dang you. I'm going to try this again. Just cuz.
I feel good. I feel bad. I feel happy. I feel sad. Am I in love? I must be in love. I feel poor, I'm in doubt, I feel sure. Am I in love? I must be in love. Any time of the day I can see her face when I close my eyes. Ooh, she's a dream. Love, I must be in love.
I know that's a good one to harmonize with. Fucker, yeah. So, you know, man, I tell you, the pastiche is strong on these songs, man. So, you know, there's a reason why after, not didn't take long, actually, after these were released, that the copyright holders of these songs, which at the time was not the Beatles in the 70s, and kind of still isn't, really, took Neil Innes to court and sued him for plagiarism because these were so well done. What ended up happening is that any future releases of these had to be credited as Neil Innes, Lennon McCartney, or Harrison, and whatever, you know, depending on the pastiche he was working on, right? And I don't believe he ever got residuals for these songs, which is just fucking, I find that, I mean, it's just criminal, really. At least that's, if I'm remembering it correctly, unless things have changed, over the years, and I know he was in and out of court a few times regarding this stuff, I think even to the point of where he connected with McCartney at some point and said, hey, not for nothing, but, you know, come on. You know, it's like I wasn't, you know, he wasn't straight plagiarizing. It was pastiche, and that's something that was protected under like the satirical kind of rubric of that kind of work. There's no, you know, maybe that was a fair judgment to have Lennon and McCartney put as the credits, but he lost out on a lot of money, considering this is like, you know, again, 1977 when this was written, you know, and here we're still talking about it, and you know, in 2022, whatever, and the Ruddles are still a going concern on their own, just as a thing. I mean, you know, at least they were when Neil Innes was still alive. Because he would do shows with them and stuff. So, yeah, so one of those things that, you know, go for, you know, it's always the way, you know, for people that have just like the incredible talent like that. And so, yeah, that was, he got a bit screwed on that one. I actually makes me want to go and look that up again and see where that all ended up, like where it landed, to be honest. Because, like I said, some things changed over the years, but in general, I'm pretty sure he didn't see a fucking lick of money on those. Even though I think he was supposed to, in the end, he was supposed to get something, but I don't think he got much, if anything. Anyway, so I'll do one more Neil song. There's so many Ruttle songs, but there's also so many Neil Innes songs that, like I said, there's... okay, this is one I could do. This is actually a pretty simple one.
Time goes by, as we all know, naturally. People come and people go. Naturally, let's be natural. Ever since the world began, let's be natural. Every woman, every man, let's be natural. Has followed nature's plan, let's be natural. Let's be natural. Ever since the world began, let's be natural. Every woman, every man, let's be natural. Has followed nature's plan, let's be natural. Everything is everything naturally. Yeah, people cry, laugh and sing naturally. Let's be natural. Ever since the world began, let's be natural. Every woman, every man, let's be natural. Has followed nature's plan, let's be natural.
All right. That was a sort of an easier one, so easy to do, easier to do. That one's too weird. I did that one. Okay, I'll do one more Neil Innes one. This is actually one that I've done often. And this is my favorite of his, to be honest. And I originally heard this as he used to sing it as part of one of the first Monty Python live tours in the early 70s that they invited him on. In 72, I want to say. So I remember first hearing this from an import Monty Python Live at Drury Lane album that was not available in America, only other than as an import. Again, it's a piano song. Anyway, so.
How sweet to be an idiot, as harmless as a cloud, too small to hide the sun, almost poking fun at the warm but insecure and tidy crowd. How sweet an idiot and dip my brain in joy, children laughing at my back with no fear of attack, as much retaliation as a toy. How sweet to be an idiot. How sweet. I tiptoe down the street, smile at everyone I meet, but suddenly smashes through my dream. Fee-fi-fo-fum, I smell the blood of an asylum.
Blood of an asylum? But mother, I was playing so beautifully. Listen.
Fee-fi-fo-fum, I smell the blood of an asylum. Hey, you! You're such a pedant. You got as much brain as a dead end, as much imagination as a caravan site. But I still love you. Still love you. Ooh, how sweet to be an idiot. How sweet. How sweet.
That's to Neil. Long live Neil Innes. Yes. I'm going to repeat a song I did last night just because I want to remember it. Right. All right. So, yesterday I was talking about a vinyl 7-inch that I want to do. I've been wanting to do for a while. Come the new year, I'll be doing some sort of GoFundMe, Kickstarter, something or other to pay for it. But I want to be on a hunk of vinyl at least once before I die. I've been wanting to do a 7-inch of my song Other Pages, with the flip side of being just like you. I came close to doing it a number of years back when I originally was going to do it, but then, yeah, as usual, the money kind of fell through and it just kind of lay fallow. But it's just one of those projects I just want to do and get it out there. I already have the image, the picture covers ready to go, etc. It'll be a short run, you know, of like maybe 300 or something like that, you know, so limited edition, you know, maybe even numbered, you know, specific, you know. So that's the idea. So, you know, hey, if anybody's out there likes the vinyls, as the kids call it, the vinyls, vinyls plural, then yeah, so that's what I'm hoping to do. I have to find the mixes will be in mono, so they won't be it won't be stereo. It'll be like the old style 60s type of mono single. But and the mixes are already done for. They were done like ages and ages ago, and I was going to do it, but so I would still use those mixes. Anyway, so this would be the B side of it. Let's see if I can remember how it goes. It's called Just Like You. She said, I need to find someone just like you, so sweet, such care in your eyes, someone who listens just like you do and would never stoop to lie. Such a well-worn refrain, I hope to never hear again. A sickly song in my head, it comes around again and again and again. She says, I need to find someone just like you, so sweet, such a cat being fed, it comes around again and again and again. Well, every year in 10 it seems that everything might change, but still I have the same old heart that still feels disengaged. Are you just another end to song in my head, it comes around. Same thing, there's a key change in that one. That's a killer in the throat. Anyway. Thank you. seeing other people joining here, so I'll keep going for as long as my voice will hold out. I've still got maybe a couple more in me. I've been doing been online since 8 o'clock, chit-chatting and this and that. So let me see. Let me look at some things here. let's see. We're definitely not doing that one, just because it's wicked high in the melody range there. I did a bunch of my stuff the other day. I can certainly try to revisit a few things here that I either haven't done yet or, but again, I have to make sure that I can do them because there's a few here that are sort of difficult, I think is the word I'm looking for. Difficult to do. Yeah, definitely not that one. Or that one. I'm not challenging myself, is what it comes down to. With some of these, because some of these are just a little, they're nuts. Probably less, you know, some of these were written to be done in the studio only and not live, really. So I don't even know why I have have these lyric sheets as if I was going to try and do them live on my own. let's see. Yeah, no, none of those are doable, I think is what it comes down to. These are more potentially doable. Yeah, all right. I'll do a couple from the record that I'm trying to work on and finish. Let's see. Yeah, one of these days I will finish this record, I promise. That's why I'm, again, trying to do this. So, looks like I see some other folks up here on the Instagrams. I think my sister's here. And a few other folks up on the YouTube here are lurking around. Though, again, I don't know who's up on YouTube. Go ahead and, again, I'm pretty sure I haven't, let me just make sure I haven't, I want to make sure that I can, hello? Yeah, at least I'm able to put something up in there, so I'm pretty sure I left the chat available. So if you're up there and you want to say, hey, just please do, just wave from afar, which you can do on Instagram. You can just kind of wave as people come in. Anyway, I just gotta get the turnaround of the bridge correct. Let's see. Anyway, this one's called Do You Mind? Picture you want to put in your head is of a silverback gorilla dressed as a jester. Sitting at a bar with a copper top, half pint in front of him, and he's endeavoring quietly to untie pretzels. That's the image you need to start with and go from there. You can let your mind wander from there.
I am trying to untie this stubborn pretzel. It's become a useless pastime to honor. Trying not to break or crumble, but to everyone on the outside seems to be already broken. So I have to ask you one simple question. Do you mind that I still love you? Leaving the tendrils inside staring. It just ends up easier to smile as I cry. As hopeful, as hopeless than me trying to deny. You're a loved one whether you care to be or not. Nothing that you do will ever go for granted. Though a shadow of a gift is all afford me.
I'm still a man. Cling to dreams, please don't let me scare you. I'll keep it down, muffle the sound of someone who still loves you. Leaving you bulls at the hooks inside. Just ends up you and I all smiles as we hide. As helpful as helpless, who are we to
needs a lot of work on the recording for sure. Let's see. definitely not doing that one. All right, let me do the one of the country ones. I'm not going to do 27 spins tonight because my voice, the key change on that, it's already a high melody, and the key change on that is a killer, so I'm not even going to attempt it tonight. I can, you know, my voice is about ready to quit, so, but we'll see. I'll see if I can get through a couple more, and then I'll probably call it. But there's a bunch of people coming up later, I've noticed, is up on YouTube and Instagram. I'm noticing folks are kind of starting to come in at like 9:30-ish, so I don't know, I might think about starting these things even later. We'll see. As a reminder for New Year's Eve, I will be doing a show probably later, obviously to coincide with the, well, for where I am, which is on the East Coast, Eastern Standard Time, midnight. So, you know, do the math of that if you're not on the East Coast, if you're from other areas of the world, etc. New Year's Eve, so this coming Saturday, I'll be doing a later show, but I will be doing a show from home because I'm not going out. I don't normally go out. I don't go out on a regular day, let alone a holiday, and I certainly don't want to be out with all the potential loonies out there and the amateur drinkers and stuff like that. I just as soon stay the fuck home. So if you're doing the same, please pop in. I'll be doing much the same. I'll be kind of chit-chatting about this, that, or the other and playing some music and all that kind of stuff, and you know, we'll mix it up a little bit. Otherwise, obviously, I'm going to be here tomorrow night, being Friday, the 30th, as well, on regular time. Though, just for shits and giggles, I might try a later start time because I'm seeing folks coming in a little bit later. So you know, I can kind of work my, you know, I can, you know, rest the voice until a little bit later in the day. That way I can continue to go. Anyway, I'll do another one here. This is another one that's off the record I'm trying to finish. Oop, hang on. A lot of strings to keep in tune. Anyway, this one's called Next Door. Thank you.
the gold mine I lay claim to. This just isn't my time. I'll ever be on time for, and my love's always next door. My nose pressed against the cracking glass. I hear the laughter of dawn next door, next door. My love's always next door. Always 5 minutes past, like a bus you missed or a kiss thrown. Brushing gently by her cheek, like a wisp of her hair. The mark is missed again, and then that kiss winds up next door. My heart pressed against a grimy floor. I hear the laughter and more. My love's always next door. I don't have that special thing to fill in all the cracks, but I'll call for pizza at 30 minutes past, and the goddamn pizza man. Tongue lashing behind gnashing teeth. Well, it's not worth this anymore, when all my love ends up next door. My love's always next.
Definitely in the Michael Nesmith kind of arena, if you will. let's see. I'm going to try and do one that's, kind of fucked up the other night. I'm gonna try and not fuck it up tonight. I'm going to try not to fuck this one up, but this is also on the new, on the record I'm trying to finish. I don't have notes on this one. So, I'm trying to... Alright, I'm gonna fuck it up. If I fuck it up, I fuck it up. It is, like I said, this is all rehearsal, folks. I did the disclaimer at the beginning of the show. Of every show. And this is called Hearts, Clowns, and Bombs. Picture, if you will, an apartment complex, second floor, you know, bad rug, you know, in the corridor. This is also very late at night. Someone on the other side of a door banging on it. The other person on the other side of the door peering through the peephole. And in that peephole, the other person looking through it into the hallway sees an ever-changing vista of odd things going on, as depicted by the person singing it from the other side of the door somehow. This would be probably the video if I were ever to do a video of it, so... Anyways, this is called Hearts, Clowns, and Bombs. What complexion of clues do you need? What connection of words do I fit? What time do you decide where you'll let your truest heart sit? Tell me. Am I the shiniest tin man to ever undertake the lion's dare and gaze upon the fair wicked witch with the golden jet blonde hair? And I'm drives a colorful clown car stuffed with the remains of a scarecrow and ashes and a young falling and the starving mass of her barely beating heart being pulled from behind in a burning wooden cart, all driven by a dwarf called Fear. So whose heartbeat are you driven to hear? There are bombs flying over tonight, meeting death in the pale moonlight. The end of this dreaded surprise, this devil's food cake we call life. So while we wait here, can't we laugh and wait out the bombs with a draft? That one's that one. That's called the Hearts, Clowns, Bombs. This goes over well enough when I'm playing it live. whoa! Just broke a string. Wow, that's timing. Okay, well, I think that that says it all right there. Wow, okay. Well, listen, I've been playing this fucker for a number of weeks after not having played. I mean, I can still play my last song. It's, I can still go. I can still do it. But so I'm gonna play one more. But my guitar is slowly disintegrating. That's interesting. But good timing, right? So I got through that song. And the Fates either liked it or they didn't. I'm not. I don't know what to say. Or it's pure happenstance. Like I said, I've been playing the 12 pretty regularly. The past 3 weeks or whatever. And what did I break? I broke the G string there. So I think what that means is that I definitely need to go buy some fucking 12, some new strings and string this fucker, this puppy up, you know. Which, you know, that's, I'm gonna have to break. I'll probably spend most of tomorrow breaking them in, but there you go. All right, I'm going to do one more. And it's interesting, up on YouTube, I'm getting highly fluctuating numbers of people coming in and out, so it's, that's interesting. So I don't know. But anyway, this is another one. This is what, this is my outro song. This is my new outro theme song. Keeps things in perspective. Oop. It's called the Universe Song. Yeah. Just remember that you're standing on a planet that's evolving and revolving at 900 miles an hour. It's orbiting at 19 miles a second, so it's reckoned a sun that is the source of all our power. The sun and you and me and all the stars that we can see are moving at a million miles a day. In an outer spiral arm at 40,000 miles an hour, in a galaxy they call the Milky Way. Our galaxy itself contains 100 billion stars. It's 100,000 light years side to side. It bulges in the middle 16,000 light years thick, but out by us it's just 3,000 light years wide. We're 30,000 light years from galactic central point. We go round every 200 million years. And our galaxy is one of only millions and billions in this amazing and expanding universe. The universe is, itself is expanding and expanding in all of the directions it can with. As fast as it can go, at the speed of light, you know, 12 million miles a minute, and that's the fastest speed there is. So remember, when you're feeling very small and insecure, how amazingly unlikely is your birth. And pray that there's intelligent life somewhere up in space, 'cause there's bugger all down here on Earth. Yes. And on that note, seeing as how my guitar has given up the ghost, yeah, my voice is a little tired. I've been doing, went a couple hours tonight. Go figure. Okay, that's good. I will be here tomorrow night, barring, you know, floods, tsunami, whatever. Yeah, I got to go get some new strings tomorrow. So I'm going to do that. And so tomorrow, if I have new strings on the guitar, it's going to be the 12 string is going to sound even shinier. Those are, you know, those strings are old. So, I'm surprised I hadn't broken a string up to this point, to be honest. So I was due. Again, to reiterate, I will be here tomorrow, probably, you know, same-ish time, whatever. I don't know, maybe flirting with a later time, because I'm noticing more people kind of flowing through later than earlier. And then Saturday night, New Year's Eve, I will put a thing up on YouTube and Instagram to remind folks that I'll be here. I still haven't fully figured what time I'm going to start. I may start at like 10 o'clock or something like that and just go through, 2 hours until the ball drops. And then I drop, we'll see what happens. And then from there, I might take New Year's Day off, as I did last week when I took Christmas Day off. But then I will be here on the Monday, which is the second, because I actually do have that day off. That'll be my last day off. Sad it is as it is, but I will have at least gone through the experiment. From December, as I was originally, conceived, because other things, infiltrated the original concept of why I was doing this in the first place, but blah, 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 blah. And who knows? Come January, I may have to do the same thing, because I may or may not be rescheduling my surgery for my face. The next soonest it could happen would be the second week of January, which is, as I had remarked when I first looked at it, is that it is Friday the 13th. Now, unless my doctor has a, potentially either, they only do this particular surgery every second week of every month, right? So, but it falls on January, on Friday the 13th. So unless he's got a superstition and it cancels all of his surgeries that day, it's either that or it would be the perfect day for me to do the fucking surgery, wouldn't it? So, just because I'm not horribly superstitious, but it's just funny, So we'll see. I will let people know. I'm going to find out. I don't know whether or not they're still wanting me to do the surgery, if they feel safe enough. My regular doctor feels it's safe enough. They don't. Come on, guys. Let's figure it out. Is it safe or not? What am I doing here? I need this to happen. I don't need, am I alive? Yeah. Am I ambulatory? Yes. However, will this surgery potentially help in things like my breathing and my nasal passages and, the interminable fucking stuffy nose thing that I deal with and having trouble sleep all the time and, deviated septum that I have, blah, 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 blah. Well, yeah, hopefully, Will my voice be different after the fact? Might be. That's what I've been told is a possibility, which was my originally why I was scared. But at this point, I've talked myself into it. I just want to get it fucking done. I don't. At this point, it's whatever fucking happens, I need to get this done. So we'll see. I'll keep people posted. But anyway, I'm gonna leave it for the night. Thanks for hanging out, both on the Instagrams and up on the YouTubes. And I hope everybody's having a good week. Hopefully, maybe you've had some time off in between the Christmas and the New Year's holiday, and hopefully you're not sick, as some friends of mine have fallen ill with the dreaded C word, among other things. Let's hopefully move into this new year. I'm not saying the word resolution, because I have a talk about having a phobia or a superstition. That word I find dubious, in all honesty. Let's just move forward into the new year with some semblance of positivity. And this is from Captain Negative here. So shit, I'm trying. I'm doing my best. anyway, on that note, I'm gonna leave it. I will talk to you, or I will see you tomorrow night, and have a good evening.